My name is Sergei Sadovnikov, and I'm working for Kaspersky Lab. Does anybody like to write boilerplate code? Anybody here? But we need in some enum to string conversion. Yeah. Serialization, deserialization for procedures. Object RPC, proxy stubs. Yeah. ORM tasks. Yeah. GUI, controls binding and models and so on. And so on and so on and so on. The simple task, yeah? In source code, we have some enum. Only what we get, two functions which performs a conversion from enum to string and from string to enum. Familiar, yeah? At least 11 questions at Stack Overflow how to perform it simply in C++. You can follow this link. once upon a time in a bright future, with in language static reflection, we can write code in this way. So we reflect the enum, we enumerate the enum items and perform the conversion from item to string, from string to item, via in language facilities, but unfortunately not now. Now we can copy paste code, or do some template and preprocessor metaprogramming, and more. Nightmare of IDEA developers include files in the middle of the source file. It's a clang sources. Or we can do it via scripting. We found the enum in the source code via regexp and produces some output conversion function. Or we can do a mix of Ruby scripts and preprocessor and templates at a HANA code. Or we can invent our own DSL language and translator for it, and also do some conversion from one source code on the DSL to the C++ source code. It's also LLVM clang sources. Why? Why we should do this? Because we don't have static reflection in the language. And it's one reason. Another reason, C++ grammar is very complicated, and it's really hard to write C++ translator from the scratch to extract something, to generate something, and so on. But somebody have already done it for us. In our team, we have one special teammate which able to work on 24/7 schedule, able to write megabytes of source code without any complaints, always in row, earns no salary, and everybody likes him. We call him tenderly autoprogrammer. What she did? What he does? It takes a piece of handwritten C++ code and generate another piece of also C++ code. No copy-paste, no tricks on based on templates or preprocessor or something. C++ in, C++ now. We could write it with the help of slang language in tooling infrastructure. What we achieve? What the benefits of usage of the autoprogrammer in the production, in our production? high level of code generalization. You analyze in the code generation tool, you analyze the AST and produce a source code and analyze AST with extremely with all details which can be got from the source code. High level of customization. Via options, you can define the target language version, target platform, and so on and so on. No macro help, no metaprogramming. You can generate code in the way specific for this language and specific for this platform. Possible errors in code are easy to fix because you have only one point of code source, the generator, code generator. You fix error in the generator, and you fix error in all sources which this generator produces. Minimal impact on minimal impact of possible human factor because human doesn't copy paste code. Autoprogrammer does it for him. Result of generation are easy to read and understand. It's not a previous samples. And generation tool is easier to understand as well because it's a regular source code. It's not a template metaprogramming and of course, production code remains simple. Disadvantages are obviously. First of all, you need to include a new tool into your tool chain. You write this tool, you build this tool, you need to include it into tool chain, give it to developers, and so on. High level of entrance. Developer which supports the tool, needs to understand clang internals and should know what he did, what he do. Almost no ready-to-use solution. Only samples from clang documentations and maybe repositories on GitHub. Clang libraries for generation tool need to be built manually. Clang installation doesn't contain them. And of course, generation tool need to be supported and updated by someone. But I think, and my experience shows that benefits are more important than negatives. What the clang internals is? First of all, this talk describes C++ version of clang libraries, not C. It's because C libraries is more stable and more, but it more it's difficult to use C version of library for deep AST analysis. C++ libraries are better for this, and you need clang version. Of version 3.3 or newer. Current release is 4.0 and next release is 5.0. What the clang is? Clang is a compiler front end. It takes input files and produces abstracts and syntax tree. To do it, to run the compiler from your code, or run the clang front end from your code, you need to first prepare the environment, parse command line options, prepare input files, pass it to the compiler, prepare compiler front end action which performs the actual task what you want to do. And finally, invoke the compiler. This with prepared options. If compilation succeeded, you will get clang AEST unit, which contains the root of AEST 3. So, firstly, clang in clang libraries contains everything you need to invoke the compiler. It's the compiler invocation facilities, compiler options parsing tasks, fill the omitted options, and prepare the compilation environment. The second party facility is a clang front-end action. It's an abstract class. It defines the interface between compiler internals and your code. And this interface describes how you want to post-process the compilation results. Clang already contains a lot of pre-implemented front-end actions, such as object file generation, such as est printer, such as AST view, verify PCR, and so on. Source manager facility provides source code information to the compiler. It contains path to source files, path to headers, path to other files which involved in compilation. Also, it can contain memory mapped files and other. Diagnostic consumer facilities implement the strategies of diagnostic printing and generation. How to print diagnostic messages, how to handle it, how to handle fix it hints, and so on. It's also abstract class. It defines the interface between compiler and user code. This interface in Clang has many implementations, such as fixed rewriter, ignoring diag, consumer diagnostic printers, and others. So, the compilation task, the compiler invoked. Invocation produced AST. What is AST? Everybody know what is AST or don't know? AST, abstract syntax tree, the tree which contains information about source code in machine in form on machine ready for analysis. Also, it provides a connection between nodes and source code, and describes source code in a form suitable for analysis. Let's say we have this function. The function is simple, takes one argument, returns int, and do some operation. From the view of compiler and view from OST, this function looks like this. So we have the root function declaration, we have param declaration, we have compose statement node, we have other nodes which describe every particular element of source code, include implicit conversion and others. So you can take this AST, you can analyze this AST and make some decision based on this AST. The whole set of clang AST classes can be divided into four big clusters. It's a cluster. It's a declaration cluster. It describes everything you can declare in source code. Includes the root of AST, translation union decal. There are a lot of classes. Describe functions, variables, classes, structs, unions, language specification. It's a part of inheritance tree from Clang. Second cluster describes the type system of C++ contains nodes for fundamental types, pointer, reference, arrays, and so on. Here it is. Different type of AST nodes. The third cluster, statement expression cluster, contains descriptions of imperative part of C++. It's statements, it's expressions, it's operators, and others. Oh, one more perfect picture. And fourth cluster contains additional classes, support classes, which helps to work with main AST nodes classes. It provides qualified types descriptions, AST context holder, doxygen comments parsing results, preprocessing results, and so on. And there are three suitable ways for AST analysis provided by clang. In XML-like terms, sex analysis possible when you write the visitor and get and the functions of visitor invoked when for every particular node. DOM-like when you traverse the tree from the top to the leaves, from the root to the leaves. And XPath-like when you describe the expression or something like expression which may extract nodes from AST. All these three ways of analysis place it in support and utility groups of classes. First of all, it's a recursive AST visitor. It's a template class which, according to CRTP pattern, allows you to write your own visitor for AST. The visitation is a traversal process, AST3 traversal process. From the view, from the point of view recursive AST visitor, consists of three different types of methods. Traverse methods, which actually traverse the nodes from root to the leaves. Walk up methods, which allows to, for any particular node, make a calls across the AST hierarchy, AST classes hierarchy, from, let's say, from visit namespace decal to visit decal. And visitation methods, it's leaf methods, which handles the particular node of particular type. And this visitor covers the whole AST3 and any AST class covered by this visitor. And there are another visitors in utility set of classes, which helps you to traverse particular types of trees, such as types visitor, can traverse types part of AST classes, declarations visitors for declarations, statements visitor for statements, comments visitor for doxygen comments. You can, these visitors doesn't perform traversal itself, but for every node, a particular method of visitor will be called. Clang as the matchers, set of classes, provide the XPath-like analysis of AST. So, as I said, you can define the properties of nodes, which kind of nodes you want to extract, properties of these nodes, and AST matchers extract these nodes from the AST and provide it, provide them to you. Also, big set of classes named clang-tooling helps you to invoke the compiler, helps to prepare compiler environment, helps to analyze options, helps to invoke compiler and do perform analysis. So, how to write generation tool from these big set of classes and utilities? Let's return to the previous example. We want to write the tool which will generate conversion functions for some enums. Let's say that enum to string conversion will look like this, will be implemented via a switch statement, and backward conversion will be implemented via array of pairs and binary lookup of this vector. Sorted, with, of course, sorted array of items. First of all, we need to describe the options, which options of the command line. So, which options will be tool specific, and which options will be clang specific, and we need to distinguish from one from another. To perform this task, we need to use LLVM cell facilities. It's a command line parsing engine of LLVM and a common option parser from clang tooling library. So let's say we will have only one tool specific option which specify output file name. We describe code generation category, which will cover these options, describe the option itself, describes command line helpers, and then we pass to common option parser, argc, argv, and this category. Common option parser parses these command line, prepare environment, and do some other preparations. Of course, you can omit clang specific options if you use command compilation database feature of the CMake build system, but only for CPP files. Another feature that tool-specific options should be separated from compiler-specific options via double dash pseudo option. And by default, the default input files to process is a part of tool-specific options and positional options. So after we parsed options, now we should prepare compiler invocation and environment. To do it, we should use clang tool class and its instance. Also, we should instantiate MatchFinder class, which will extract AST nodes from AST. And also, we need to think about strategy of multiple files processing. So, instantiate clang tool, instantiate MatchFinder, nothing more here. List of source files we pass to the tool constructor. About multiple file processing. By default, clang tool processes each file separately from another. It runs a compiler for each input file. If you want another processing, for example, one compiler run for the whole set of files, you need to do some additional preparations. And then we need to describe AST matcher which will describe which AST nodes will be extracted from AST. And also we need to implement a match callback interface, which is interface between the matcher and your code. The matcher will call this interface every time he matches the node. And after this preparation, we need to pass this data to the finder class. So we need to extract enums. We need to extract items from enums. So enum is a declaration from the C++ point of view. So we declare declaration matcher. We tell the matcher that we need only enums from input files. And what the result of matching should be bind to results under enum name. Then we implement a match callback interface. This interface contains three methods, but method run is the most important. This method accepts the result of matching and provides the access to the found nodes. We defined enum name previously, and now they access the enums by this name. And then we do some analysis. Then we have to set up finder. We instantiate enum handler. We previously define enum matcher and pass it to the add matcher method. Then we are ready to run the compiler. We call the run method and matcher provides the matching results. No rocket science, very simple. Actually, it's a basic skeleton of the clang tool main function, more or less. Finder passed to run method via front-end action factory, which instantiate front-end action for every input file. That was the simple part. Now we should analyze AST. Matching result in the run method provides us particular AST nodes. We need to understand what is this node and the properties of these nodes. It doesn't simple, actually, because as you have seen previously, clang AST is extremely fine-grained and detailed. So also the type part of AST is hard to process and hard to analyze. And your code may contain specific constructions such as inline and anonymous namespaces, which can break the idiom. For instance, std string from the compiler point of view looks like std cxx11 basic string. No cxx11 in the original declaration. But in the code, you will get this string. Also, if you enum or declaration inside anonymous namespace, compiler provides you this qualified name. It's curiously. It's not a valid C++ identifier, so you can't use it as is. The simple cases of analysis, which don't involve that problems, are simple enumeration of classes in enums, and namespaces, within namespaces, within scopes, and do simple transformation with them without deeper analysis. In some cases, that's enough, but in other cases, you need to do deeper analysis. For example, if you want to understand relation between times, you want to analyze types hierarchy, you want to do specific you want to perform specific behavior for particular types based on particular types and so on. The types problem. What's the problem with these types? In source code, you have declarations. Yeah? You have, it's a identifier, it's a type. In AST, you have qual type. It's a special class, which actually erases the type. You can achieve the type. You can get the type from qual type, but type of this declaration, it's a, you need to do several transformation with qual type. Another sample. Let's say we have some class declaration we quoted, and we want to get some other class which is a template parameter of some template base class. This is a way. Bingo. 13 steps. To travel from one declaration to another. You can simplify this process, and you can write the special facility, special analyzer, which transform qual type to the simpler form of representation. Another feature. You may want to mark some declaration or some statements with additional attributes. For example, you can mark structures as serializable. Until C++ 17, you can do it with the language construction because attribute set is closed. You can extend it, but you may want it. What you can to do? You can use doxygen comments. Your doxygen comment can contain additional attributes for the declarations and so on. You can get them via comment visitor. You can take AST node and get documentation from it and analyze this documentation for the attributes. And then change the behavior of your tool according to found attributes. For example, ignore non-serializable structures. Summing up, in our tool, in order to generate something, we need to extract AST nodes, desired AST nodes, need to filter them, need to perform deeper analysis, extract attributes if needed, transform types and declarations and nodes to the simpler form. And then we able to generate something. For our sample, let's write the simpler form of such kind of enum descriptor. We have enum name, we have isscoped flag, so is enum scoped or no. And the vector of strings, which describes enum items. So, in our enum handler, which accepts the result of AST matching, we need to collect, we need to create this descriptor and provide access to collection of these descriptors. So, enum declaration analysis, pretty simple. We get the name, we get scoped flag, we enumerate enum items, and then sort them and push to the vector. And the doc is method from the run callback. Nothing more here. After we did it, after we do it, we are ready to generate. We can validate the intermediate form of AST. We can output to our own diagnostic. And if everything is okay, write generation artifacts. So we have output file options. We create output file, generate an error, and write the conversion functions. The conversion functions are also pretty simple. Based on enum descriptor, it generates the desired code. Enum to string conversion and backward conversion from string to enum. Which problems could be here? Declaration and named declaration has nodes has a method get qualified name and string. As described in documentation, it returns a qualified name of the declaration. But if your declaration in the anonymous namespace, or the result is informed C++ identifier. So in some cases, you need to build a qualified declaration by yourself. Or you can use clang print method to convert from a node from binary representation into string human readable representation, but it doesn't care about formatting. And be careful with bool type, because from the clang point of view, bool type is underscore bool. Two words about tool diagnostic output. It's a good idea to output this diagnostic in the same form, in the same format as a compiler does it. Also, because in this case, you can navigate by this diagnostic from IDE. Also, clang diagnostic which produced by clang should be suppressed, because if you process in compiler specific headers, specific for MSVC, not for clang compiler. Clang can generate a lot of errors on these files. And of course, your own diagnostic should contain source location information, which problem. So the code written, how to build it. To build the clang tool based tool, you need to firstly build the clang, because C++ clang libraries doesn't include in the clang installation. So to do it, you need to install CMake-built system, and you need, of course, build the clang and your tool with the same toolchain, with the same compiler, with the same settings, due to avoid language problems. The basic way to build your tool after that is to follow the instruction from the clang site, clang documentation site. Put your tool into clang source tree, run the CMake, and the tool will build. Will be built. More harder way is to write build instructions by yourself, but it's a little bit harder because this is for our sample. This is a whole CMake for building, nothing more. You define the installation prefix for LLVM. You define you include LLVM and clang modules. You include you declare the executable as LLVM executable, and define the set of libraries you need to link with. It's a set of clang libraries. Without any of it, the tool won't build. So we build it. How can we use it? The basic way: run from the command line. We specify the output file for generation. We need to specify input file and specify additional compiler options. For header files, this specification is necessary because by default, header files with H extension interpreted as C files, not C++. Also, you should pass include files, you should pass defines, because clang performs the whole compilation process. And clang should produce AST in the same way as your primary compiler does it. And as I said before, with H files, with header files, you can rely on compilation, CMake compilation database, because it doesn't contain entries for H files. But you may want to integrate your generation tool with your build system. Let's say with CMake with build system. It's an easy way. How to do it? You add custom comment instruction into your CMake, which invokes the generation tool. Pass to this comment all necessary arguments, and include generation result in your target sources list. It's a template. What we do here? We prepare a directory for output file. We add comment, specify output file, which will be generated, which should be generated. We invoke the generation tool name, output file, compiler settings, define the dependencies, and define the comment for run log. And finally, we include the generated enum file into target sources list. That's all. Now, when you build your project, the generation tool will be invoked. For other build systems such as QMake, Makefiles, MSBuild, BGM, and so on, you need to consider build system documentation how to include custom generation tool into build process. And finally, now we can use our generation results in the source code. We include it as an include file and test that everything is okay. That's all. Bingo. The generation tool is done. We use the same tool in our production. For what we use? Of course, enum to string conversion generation. three types of data serialization. We have handwritten structures and generate JSON serialization, binary serialization, and others. We generate object RPT, proxy, proxy and stubs implementations. We generate pimple-based components implementations. We generate mocks for interfaces and configuration data validators. And we won't generate more, actually, because not every day, but often new tasks and new tasks to generate are apparent. Useful links. CLang up-to-date documentation site. It contains all instructions how to how to build tools, how to use tools, how to use AST matchers, and so on. CLang actual doxygen documentation. It's a doxygen docs generated from source code. A very interesting place. It will be your favorite place when you try to use these methods. Enum to string generation tool example on my GitHub. And slides about CLang AST from the CLang guys. It's not up to date, but useful. Because I provide only brief description of CLang AST.